some people exist before they're allowed to be free. How many times can a man turn his head and pretend that he just doesn't see? The answer, my friend, she's blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. Is blowing in the wind.
The day that he was killed. But I was little bit on the crazy side for some time. And there's a beautiful lady in town that probably most of you all know, Elsa Campbell. She and I worked for hospice at that time. And Elsa is a very qualified therapist. But we had an appointment to go help someone else. And Elsa, I could woke up that morning and I couldn't move and I couldn't understand that. And so Elsa got the manager of our apartments to come and let her in. And I said to her, I don't know what's wrong with me. And she said, well, I do. This is a time you're not helping someone else and it's different when it's yours. So we will get you up and we will get you moving. And she did all that. So I was very grateful for her help. But I was sitting and thinking about last night about a little boy who loved the outdoors so that he was playing in the creek and he found this really ugly, ugly frog, you guys. I mean, it must have been from the dinosaur age. It had warts and all kinds of things. And he thought it was beautiful. And the frog was to be named Charlie. So Charlie came to live with us. And he was also the kind of child that everything that had four legs and a tail wagging and looked like it was hungry wound up at our house. He was the keeper of Christmas, as all children are, and he found all the children in the world that wasn't going to get anything for Christmas. I don't know why he thought we were rich, but somehow the things came and we spread all that kind of sunshine around. So my infant daughter, that died, only lived about 27 hours before she went to live with the angels. She was six and a half months and her heart was leaking and her lungs weren't developed enough to get her through that. So then my other daughter had cystic fibrosis when there was not a great deal of help about that. And she had a German shepherd named who knew that she was sick before we did. And the way she wanted to leave this planet was to see Randy. And in those days, you couldn't have an animal in the hospital. So our chief of staff that I worked for, I went out and told him that I had sent for the dog and there was no one in the hospital big enough to stop it. He said, well, I'll go get it. So anyway, Randy got up on the bed with Angela and she said she had a secret to tell him. And so she whispered something to him and left the world very peacefully after all of her struggles. But about 11 days later, Randy joined her because he kept going to the cemetery and laying down on the grave. And I would bring him home, I took the bed with me. None of that worked. But the thing that I saw in my children that I lost, what I wanted to share with other parents here who have gone through this as well, is I do remember the love and I remember the hope they all had for the world. Because I tell you, if my son could have fixed everybody and gave them the best job in the world, he would have done that. And I'm sure it wasn't anything to do with me because I believe these angels come into the planet knowing what their purpose is. I truly believe that. Because if he ever said, I don't think you ought to do that, they're going to mother, you know nothing, right? So I think that they know what their purpose is on earth. And I know that God blessed me with those three. And I'm very blessed. I have two more daughters that so far they're still with us. And I'm very grateful for that. And I'm very grateful for all the parents that had the courage to come today and talk about this a little bit. I know that the recovery is a very hard thing to do. And often people don't, it's not that they don't care that you've lost someone. They just don't know what to say to you. So don't get mad if you see your best friend and they go, well, did you know it's snowing outside or something cute like that? I hope that there will come a time when those of us who see others in pain can have a better way to communicate. So with that, I'm going to introduce our special angel, Miss Holly Doreen. Would you please come up, Holly? Thank you. Please come up, Holly.
Thank you, Sammy. I did bring a picture of my son. He gave me away at my wedding to my beautiful husband. And I didn't know where to put it.
That's okay.
I will just put it right here. And I'm just gonna preface this by saying this is my story and in my experience, and each one of us have our own, but somehow they join. And I guess today is where they join for many of us. I lost many throughout my lifetime. When you start to get my age, you do. And I lost the majority of my family, starting with my brother when I was 15 years old. And on his headstone says, "Rest his soul." Freddie was his name. And he was blonde hair, blue-eyed. Boy, he was a hellion. And he said, his headstone says, "Rest his soul." And 3 years later, I lost my dad. And it took me 10 years to find where he was buried. And in 1999, I should say, we lost my beautiful sister. She's up in Woodland, California, and on her plaque, it says, "No me olvida." No me olvidas, which means do not forget me. And we lost my mother, and we moved her up there as well. And then we lost Joseph a couple years ago, Joseph Walker Hermosillo. Blonde hair, blue-eyed Mexican, that you would never know it, except he was, you know, very, very proud of his name. We named him Walker. His middle name was Walker. He was named after Joseph Redford Walker, who was a mountain man that made trails. He didn't follow people, he made trails, and that stood true to Joseph's life. He was I don't know how I was blessed, but he was hell on wheels. And the most loving kid you could ever imagine. I remember one Mother's Day, I took him horseback riding with some friends, and I came home to take a nap. And I had found out when we were out horseback riding, he had broken into his piggy bank, and he had taken a sock, and he had put all of his change out of his piggy bank in this sock, and he had it in his pocket. And I was furious with him because he wasn't supposed to touch that money. That was money for him, you know, later on. And I went in and I took him a nap. And he was upset because I was upset with him. And he came in a little while later and he woke me up and he said, "Mom, do we have any scotch tape?" He was only like 5. "Mom, do we have any scotch tape?" "Yes, Joseph, it's in the junk drawer in the kitchen." I went back to sleep. He went in there. He comes back and he goes, "Mom, do we have any wrapping paper?" "Yes, Joseph, it's in the closet." And I was still frustrated because I will tell you that it was a part of my life that I'm not real proud of, but it was where I was at the time when he was just 5. And I want to say that I was probably drinking a little bit, way too much. Maybe it had to do with the losses in my life. And I never knew how to deal with them. It is what it is. I woke up from my nap, and there was this halfway wrapped bouquet of yellow roses that he had gone out into the backyard at 5 years old and cut and put next to me with a little card that said, "Happy Mother's Day." And when I finally woke up and realized why he took his money, he says, "Mom, I was hoping I could get an opportunity to go buy him something for Mother's Day." And not very long after that, I got clean and sober. And I've been clean and sober ever since. And this is not a testament for a 12-step program. This is just my story. When we... you know, it's the fear of every mother that doorbell rings. And, you know, Joseph was like I say, he was my knucklehead, and he did quite a few things in his life that even he wasn't proud of, and he ended up on the wrong side of the law many times, but that didn't mean that he wasn't a loving, loving spirit. And that showed at his memorial, when there was over 300 people at his memorial, and a huge motorcycle ride from Santa Paula all the way out to Ojai was such a tribute. And the things that people said and the things that people did when he passed away were just so unbelievable to me. But when you get that knock on the door and there's two policemen standing there, and you know because he's old enough that they're not coming here to tell you that they've arrested your son. And they said, "Do you know Joseph Hermosillo?" And I knew, and I looked up and I saw the little cross on one of the uniforms. And I said, "What's happened to him? Because you're not here to tell me that he was arrested." And that's a chaplain, and I know what that means. And they couldn't tell me anything, because they didn't know. And I'll tell you that he was killed on a motorcycle at 4 o'clock in the morning in Los Banos because he went to sleep trying to get home. Because that was just the free spirit that he was. He wanted to be home with his kids. He had two beautiful, beautiful children. And I don't know why, but this story isn't anything like I had envisioned when I started on this path. And Sammy said, "Will you do this?" And I said, "Well, of course, but I believe in a God of my understanding. And I believe that when I ask for a sign, show me some kind of sign. I asked for a sign this morning. And I have a sign on my wall. I have a sign on my wall." And that, it flapped in the wind. I was walking into the kitchen and I looked out and it flapped in the wind like this against the wall. And all of a sudden the door just slammed shut. Okay, I'm supposed to go over and read this sign because I haven't looked at it in a long time. So I took a picture of it. And it hangs on my wall, and it's been a long time since I read it. But it says, "In the end, what matters most is how well did you love? How well did you live? And how well did you learn to let go?" And that's by the Dalai Lama. I had signs before my son passed away. I had signs the day he passed away. I knew he was living on borrowed time. I knew that his 9 lives were up. And I think he did too. It doesn't make the path any easier. I told my husband last night, I said, "You know what, I'm so resistant to going tomorrow. I just don't want to share. I just don't want to do it." He goes, then that's what you're supposed to share. Is the process. And the process for me has been, show me a sign, let me see it, and let me acknowledge that as God is my son saying, "It's okay, Mom. It's okay. And it's okay to let go. I will never, ever let go of memories. But what I need to let go of is the pain and the hurt. It has stopped me from having conversations with people. It has kept me in my house by myself. It has kept me in a state of being angry and sad. And it has sometimes been the driving force behind the tenacity that I have to get through that day. And I can't explain it, but the only thing that I need to let go of is the pain. And I described, and I'll try to make it real quick. I described yesterday to Martine that I keep seeing this balloon filled up and this child running around with this big balloon that's nice and stiff and it's all up there. And then we lose somebody and there's a little bit of that balloon that just kind of deflates. And the people around you kind of share with you and hold you up and walk you through, and the balloon starts to get a little bit stiff again and rises up. And then something else happens. We lose another one. And it gets harder and harder and harder for that balloon to stay afloat. And when you lose a child, it's like all the air comes out of that balloon. And there's nothing, nothing that's going to put that back up except hope. My mother's headstone, on my mother's plaque, it says, "Siempre hay esperanza." There's always hope. Those are the things I have to hold on to. The things that mean so much to me, that there is goodness in life, there is love in life, and I have to be the one that says, I can do this just one more day. I had a high school friend who lost her husband yesterday, and through the process of dying of cancer, I did one thing every day. I sent her a text, and today the text was, I have a little extra strength and I'm sending it to you. That's all it takes. And that gave me the feeling that I've done something to help her fill her balloon back up again. Thank you for filling my balloon. It's starting to float again. And I appreciate each one of you. Thank you.
Mention that I have cards up here. We have a wishing tree which was donated by Bill Quinlan. And you know, every time an angel gets his wings, a bell rings. So I want everybody to take one of the bells and put it in your car, take it home, do whatever with it. And I have the cards and the hangers up here, so when we take a little break in a little while, we'll let everybody fill out their wish. Our next speaker is Ms. Kay Wilson Bolton, who really needs no introduction, who also brought tons of great goodies in the kitchen. Martha got a great big cake, so ma'am, we're all gaining 10 pounds today, okay? Thank you. Thank you. Life goes, my comments today were even adjusted last night to accommodate the new and recent experience, and the matter of life and death is fresh again for me. On Friday, I was with a family whose teenage daughter committed suicide on 126 by flinging herself in front of the semi-truck. The grief of the family was so profound that it was hard to say anything to them. The Sheriff's Department called me back to their home yesterday to continue the conversation with their 9 and 15-year-old daughters and to begin the contemplation that God knows sorrow, confusion, and anguish. In my 9 years of serving the Ventura County Fire Department as chaplain, after the initial time to provide the simple ministry of presence, I find I am unable to truly comfort someone without relying on what God's word says about death and dying. In the 14th chapter of John, Jesus says, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you with me so that you may be where I am." I believe it is there that we're going to find our children. It would be natural to dwell on the fact that children of any age, if their parents are living, do did not live long enough. We grieve they will never know the full meaning of life and the joy that can be found in it. Another view of this, however, is to not grieve because of the lost relationship, but to rejoice because of their deliverance from this earth and all the things that make us cry. To put a bow around that thought, the prophet Isaiah wrote in chapter 57, "Good people pass away. The godly often die before their time, but no one seems to care or wonder why. No one seems to understand that God is protecting them from the evil to come." Even King David wrote in Psalm 6, "I'm weary with my sighing. Every night I make my bed swim. I dissolve my couch with my tears." He lost a young son. So Holly and Sammy, I know you know what that means, to drench your bed with tears. I used to think that the term "there's nothing new under the sun" began with my mother, but I found out it was actually King Solomon that made that statement. There is nothing new under the sun. In Matthew 11, Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." God knows about the love of a child and the sorrow of loss. He allowed his own son to die in our place and pay for our sins so we don't have to. We do not understand why our children experience an early death, but we can rest in knowing that God does. An unusual verse in Psalm 115 says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of one of his saints." We wonder how this can be. Death to us means sadness for the break in relationship. But to God, death restores the initial relationship, and there's a reunion with our Heavenly Father. We can take comfort in the thoughtful view of death and contemplate it maybe in a different way. I commend a book to you called From Grief to Glory, written by James Bruce. It's a story of famous parents who have lost children and how they process their own grief. Did you know that Johann Sebastian Bach had 20 children and lost 13 of them? Yet he was able to compose some of the world's most beautiful music and poetry. Could it be his intimate experiences with grief shaped his soul? In that same book, Harry Wesley wrote, describing the valley of weeping, and Holly just talked about that valley that you feel you'll never get away from. He writes that real grief is not easily comforted. It comes like ocean waves rushing up the sand, subsiding back only to roll in again. The waves vary in size, frequency, and intensity. Some are small, lapping around the feet. Others are stronger. They foam the water around you and cause you to stagger. Then there are the overwhelming waves with an undertow that can turn your world upside down and drag you out into deep waters. In times such as those, the mourner desperately needs an anchor. And indeed, God has promised his people a blessing if they patiently endure. He has guaranteed the promise so that we might lay up the hope set before us. This hope is the anchor of the soul. It is sure and steadfast. As a chaplain, I have sat with many people who have lost loved ones of all ages in the most tragic of circumstances. There's often silence as they simply provide a ministry of presence. After the initial shock, the situation always resolves into moments of processing the death to search for meaning. I have witnessed many times the difference in the grief of those who have no hope of seeing their loved one again and those who know they will. The Apostle Paul writes in 1 Thessalonians 4:12, "Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. Our hope is in the name of the Lord." My greatest personal comfort is found in John 16:21, when Jesus is talking to his disciples and says simply, "There will come a day when you won't have to ask me any questions." Many times I've been so drenched in the grief of others and my own that I raised a fist demanding to know why. I long for the day when the whole story of eternity is laid before us and none of us will have to ask any questions. So just let me pray for us, if I could. Heavenly Father, I thank you for gifting us with children. You know the depths of grief and the stories of those not fully written on earth. Comfort us, God, ease the ache, and give us peace and good sleep. Bless the hearts of those here who know this particular pain. We bless your name, Father, for you are a good God who longs to give all of your children good things. You are the great comforter, and we ask you to do that now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
This song is House at the Corner, and if you know it, please sing along, and if you don't, you could hum along.
Came about
And then from there, share what we're doing and how you can be a part. So, my story begins back in around 2004 at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, on the side of the country. And a cardiologist by the name of Dr. Brian Hannah came to me and looked me in the eye and said, somewhat matter-of-factly, this is going to turn your lives upside down. Really what you want to hear when you have a child in the hospital. What did he mean and why was he saying that? Well, just a few moments before, he broke the news to us that our youngest son, Timmy, had been diagnosed with a cardiopulmonary disease called pulmonary arterial hypertension, PAH. Now, PAH is a mean, nasty disease. It's a degenerative, terminal illness. There are no cures for it, even today, and all they can do is basically stem the progression of the disease. And in fact, it involves having 24/7 intravenous drug. It's a complete change in lifestyle for the child, but also for the family, because we have to make up drug daily and so on. Over the next 3.5 years, we saw our fun-loving, gregarious, outgoing little boy completely transformed in a bad way. Basically, over the course of 3.5 years, he gradually had more and more meds, more and more visits to the hospital. The final year of his life, he was in the hospital for 26 weeks out of the final 52. And eventually, in February 2008, he died of congestive heart failure, which is a normal progression of that disease. We were told he had 3 to 7 years to live. He got 3.5. So it was at that point in February 2008 that I joined the club, so to speak, the club that many of you are that we wouldn't ever choose for our best friends. That club of those of us who don't even have a name, some of you may have heard this before, but you know, if you're an orphan, sorry, if you're a child who's lost both parents, you've been known as an orphan. If you're a husband that's lost a wife, you're a widower. If you're a wife that's lost a husband, you're a widow. What do you call someone who's lost a child? There's not even a name for us. It's that heinous that there's no word in society even for that. There's an aspect of child loss as well, which again, speakers you've already heard, are very familiar with, that unlike any other loss, it's not just a loss at the time, but it's kind of cyclical, and year on year on year, there are reminders that come up beyond simply birthdays and the anniversary of death and Thanksgiving and Christmas, which are coming up, but also milestones that other children typically go through. So learning to drive a car, graduating high school, going off to college, graduating college, getting married, and eventually grandchildren. So when you lose a child, you lose all of those things as well. And that's a part of the whole mix. I did want to mention one somewhat raucous birthday party that we had. And to some it may seem a little strange and almost irreverent, but for us it was the important thing to do. I mentioned he died in February 2008. On March 2nd was his birthday. So he actually died 8 days before his birthday. So we held his memorial service on his birthday, which was obviously bittersweet. It was the day he came into the world and the day we celebrated him leaving. But we held a Shrek birthday party, since that was his favourite movie, complete with cake and helium balloons and that music, which was just the way he would have wanted it. And that actually plays into a lot of what I'm going to say and what Fly Hope Dream is about, and what I'm pleased to see even in the notes for this meeting, and that's the whole concept of celebrating our child's lives. So, firm believer that healing comes from remembering. and celebrating the life that our children lived, not simply focusing on what we lost, but focusing on what we had and still have. So for example, I'm still Timmy's dad. He's no longer with us, but I don't stop being Timmy's dad. And it's important to focus on those things and not to simply focus on the grieving and what we lost. So each year since he died, I would take the day that he died, the anniversary, and spend the day thinking about him, pondering him, reflecting, looking at old pictures and so on. Some years I'd do that on his birthday as well, which is only a week later. Both days within the week. Often remembering and celebrating with chocolate and chicken fingers, because those are the two things that he ate. I wouldn't say they're his favourite foods, they're almost the only thing he ate for the last two or three years. That's all he wanted. But about 5 years ago, on the anniversary of one of those anniversaries, I just thought, okay, it's time to try to help others. How can I help others to celebrate their children taken too soon? What am I going to do? You know, what can I do? And you may be asking the same question for yourselves. And I thought, okay, what's unique about me? And it didn't take me too long. I've got one talent, skill, if you can call it that, that not many people have, less than 1% of the population, and that's that I'm a pilot. I'm not a commercial pilot, I don't fly commercial planes. This is just for recreation, for fun. But in addition to that, I have a plane. And the plane I have, you have a picture of it. It's a rather special 1942 Stearman biplane. And that was the primary trainer, one of the primary trainers in the Second World War. She's 75 years old next year. Beautiful, graceful bird. And I thought, okay, I love to fly. And I've got something here in terms of an asset, both in terms of the plane itself and my experience, and maybe there's a way that I can use that. I've always found flying to be therapeutic and freeing and relaxing. Alone with your thoughts, you know, I can leave behind the deadlines and hustle and bustle and pressure of everyday life. And just be. And I won't say every time I fly, I don't remember Tim, think of Tim, but he is actually there as a picture on my instrument panel, right there with every flight. So I thought, wow, is there a way to use that passion for flying, to use that passion for aviation, and together with my affinity with the people who have lost children, is there a way to use that to somehow be a catalyst for change in their lives? Could I work with parents, grandparents, and siblings to maybe just give them a little bit of fresh hope to spur them on to celebrate their own child's life? Another aspect of my thinking was, well, one of the things you can do with a plane is get a completely different perspective on the world. And the illustration I've used stayed near the mic. Illustration I've used a number of times. If you imagine that this is a building, all right, it's an iPhone, but imagine it's a building, and you're the height of this little button. If you're standing right up against the building, you really can't see around it. It's just too big. It's over it, around it. And if that's a metaphor for grief, that's what it's like when you first lose a child. It's like it's overwhelming. Nothing beyond the grief, and you can't see, it's completely overshadows everything. Well, if you get, say, 500 to 1,000 feet in the air, this monstrous building now just looks like this. So it's nowhere near as intimidating, and you can see beyond it and around it, you can see there's something on the other side. Also, to use another analogy, if that's the building, and I have a plane on the ground, as I take off, the further I go from the building, the smaller it becomes. So if that's a sort of a metaphor for the grief process, it's overwhelming at first, but there is a progression that gradually the grief becomes more bearable. So anyway, last fall, exactly this time of year, I was finally ready to answer the questions, you know, answer the what ifs, what if I could do something, and I decided to give it a go. Fairly dramatic, I decided to jump in the plane and fly it from Pennsylvania, halfway between New York City and Philadelphia, where I lived at the time, to here. Nearly 3,000 miles, in an open cockpit by plane. It only does 18 to 19 miles an hour, so it's a bit like driving across the country in an open cockpit. It took 7 weeks altogether, and along the way, I told my story, this story, in somewhat abbreviated form, to local news stations. We had four pieces of news coverage, two in Virginia, one in Memphis, one in Nashville. Newspapers, grief support organizations like Grief Share, you may have heard of, and Compassionate Friends. And most importantly of all, we flew with 41 different families, 67 individuals who flew with me, with passengers aged from 8 to over 80. Didn't matter what age. And I've got many, many testimonials I can share with you, but one in particular seemed to sort of capture it. So I'll read what someone said. They said, "Fly Hope Dream was a breath of fresh air, literally and figuratively, for so many traveling the weary road of grief after the death of a child. This experience had a 100% smile initiation rate, even if through a few tears." And that just captures it. 100% smile initiation rate. And some of you are smiling even now, and you've not even been in the plane yet. You've got a treat to come. So, why does it work? Well, firstly, there's the magic of open cockpit flight. I've done a flyer now. The last 300 in the open cockpit biplane, it is so much different to even regular small planes. It's completely different to being in a commercial airline. But you just have to believe me, it's a special experience, at least for now, but you can come and try it. The secret sauce, though, is that I've been where my passengers are. I've lost a child myself, and therefore there's that ability just to connect, as we've heard about already this afternoon. Most parents that have lost children feel that nobody else understands except for another parent who's lost a child. And I've heard that so many times as I was coming across the country. So, what about you guys? Well, I want to invite you to come and fly with us. Basically, flights for parents, grandparents, siblings are at no cost. We're a 501c3 non-profit, we rely on donations, business sponsorships and so on, grants, but we want you to come and fly with us at no cost to you. We guarantee it will inspire you, provide some hope. It doesn't matter what stage of the grief journey you're on. I flew across the country, and I've now flown several flights here in South Point too, by the way. But I've flown with one family, 12-year-old girl who committed suicide just 2 weeks prior to our arrival, after I'd even left Pennsylvania. It's like 4 weeks into the trip, I'm in Nashville. I flew with another family whose children had died decades before, 20 years ago. And it doesn't matter what the cause of death is. What I've discovered is it doesn't matter how old the child was, what the cause of death was, how long ago it was. The issues are the same. Different stages of the process, but it's a journey that never ends, as we all know. So, what if you've never flown in a small plane before? Come try it. And I've now flown at least 6 or 8 people where it was not only their first flight in a small plane, it was their first flight, period. I flew one guy in his 50s who had never flown. Wow. Amazing. And he loved it. What if you're scared of heights? Guess what? So am I. I actually don't like, for example, going up on a ladder. The top wing of the plane is something like going to 10 feet in the air. To go and clean the top wing, I've got to be high up the ladder. I hate it. There's a common misconception that if you have a fear of heights, you look like flying. It's completely different. I don't get into the psychology and the science around it. It's actually completely different, so you don't need to worry. What if you just playing scared of life or really don't like it, well, you could do it anyway. I've had several people who came and flew pretty much in honor of their child that had died, either because they wanted to conquer their own fear or because they were doing it in the child's memory, or I've heard several times that's what Timmy, you know, in my case, would have loved. So he didn't get to do it, I'm going to do it for him. And if you really don't want to fly, period, I can't persuade you, we'd still encourage you to come out and come to the airport and come to what we call family flying days. So what we do is we spend a morning or an afternoon, typically, with a family or more than one, depends on numbers and you know, so on. And we fly parents, grandparents, siblings. And then we either have lunch together or dinner together and share experience, much like we are here, just talk about our experiences, talk about how we've worked through our grief. I can share from where I am, they share from where they are. And so even if you don't want to fly, you can still come and experience and be a part with us. Again, the meals are free. And we go to pretty cool places. We either go to flight 126 to the cafe at the airport, or we the Gardens Park, or whatever. We go free meals. There is one new concept that we're just about to try, and I'll mention that just in passing. When you think about this, and you think about Fly Hope Green, as we've worked with these families, one thing that frequently comes up is how difficult it is to talk about the lost child with other people. We've mentioned it before that only another parent really gets it, but it's more than that. You've probably had the experience like I have, that if your child has passed away from the conversation, it's an instant conversation starter. So people will say to me, how many children do you have? And I'll say, my typical response is, I have three, but only two of them still with me. And typically that gets the, you know, the jaw drop and the, oh, I've just stepped into something I don't want to talk about. So one of the things that we feel as Fly Hope Green is we want to reach out to the people that have lost children, but we also want to help spread the word about what is this, what's it like, why is it, like I said, if you mention orphans in the press or you mention veterans, you know, you can, people don't immediately talk about it. There's no word that we can even put in a headline as to what we are. And you even have the, you know, do you say, bereaved parents, parents who lost a child. Yeah. I never liked that phrase because I thought, am I going to find them again? But some people are offended if you say your children died or passed away. So one of the things we're looking to do is to spread this concept of celebration and to invite, and we've not done one of these yet, but we're thinking about it and we're just exploring the concept, as well as inviting a family to say, well, if there's a particular milestone that's coming up, like a graduation, and my son Timmy didn't graduate because he died at age 11. All his friends had graduation parties, I had nothing to celebrate at that time. But if in lieu of something like that, you would be interested in celebrating your child with a broader group of people, with your extended family, with your friends, and we believe that would be a way to facilitate conversation with them, a way for them to understand that it's okay to talk your child, to talk about your child, and to mention your child's name. Like, especially when we're coming up to Christmas and holidays, I tend to find people don't want to talk about Timmy because Timmy isn't hearing it. Well, of course, we want people to talk about children and to remember them. It's one of the worst things that people don't say anything. So we're introducing that concept, and it's just something to think about. What we're going to do with those is, obviously we can't give away free flights to everybody because the plane costs a lot to keep in the air, but what we're looking to do is say, if you were to get a commercial, you know, back in like off the internet, it's about $300 for half an hour. We're going to offer those rides about 50%, so $149 for anyone who wants to come who isn't an immediate family. And then, depending on how this works out, we'll start trying to do some of these on a regular basis and encouraging the communication to the wider community and the immediate family and the people that are closest. I've talked long enough, let me just wrap it up by saying, let's just return a moment to Children's Hospital Philadelphia in 2004. I can't believe it's that long ago. And has my life been turned upside down? Upside down by some of the circumstances. But with 8 years of this grief journey under my belt, what I can tell you is this, it's not all bad. There is a silver lining to the cloud. Flying is enabling me to find hope again, and eventually we start dreaming again. And our goal at Fly Hope Dream is to help some of you to do the same. So the information that I've handed out contains the address of our Facebook page, the web address, and on there's a button to request a flight. So I'd encourage you to sign up, but also let anyone know you think might be a candidate that isn't at this meeting. I've got plenty of extra materials if anyone wants to take those. But we'd love to start to meet you down at the airport. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. That's so neat. What kind of plane do you call that?
It's a 7-5
plane. Okay. All right. For our next speaker, that is my buddy, and I'm so happy that he just won the election again. Please welcome Mr. Martin Hernandez.
Well, I just want to make this short. Like I told him in the parking lot when we arrived, I was supposed to say something, so it's going to be even shorter. But I do want to honor all of you for the bravery that it takes for you to come here, particularly for those of you who have lost a child, to share about that. You know, I know Joseph half of my life and the majority of his. And one thing I can tell you about, he certainly was my son. Would tell people how much he loved me, and we had this really wonderful, sometimes shaky, but for the most part, we had a very deep love for one another. And I'll tell you, the thing that was hardest for me was to, as a spouse, was to support my wife, and just be there. You know, as a man, I will admit, I want to fix everything. She'll tell you, I still do that today. Sometimes she has to shoo me away because she's like, if I need your help, I'll ask you. Yes, ma'am. And I kind of step away with things around the house. But with the grieving, it's sometimes it's more important to have that quiet strength to stand there and let her lean into me or reach out or just put her arms out for a hug. It was really tough. I've been with her for most of the losses she's had in her life from her family, and it's been tough. But I know that for me, with my foundation and my higher power, and knowing where my strength is, that it, I want to think that it helps even quietly for her to know that whatever she needs, I'm always there. And I would extend that to any of you. And the one thing this has taught me the journey with her and listening to your stories is that always be mindful when you come across somebody who's a little short or a little hurt, or you feel like they snipped at us and we really don't know why, because all we were doing is trying to have a conversation with them. We just never know what they've been through and or when that was. It could be yesterday or it could be a decade or two ago. The pain, I know, at least in what I've seen, my loved one is, I haven't seen it lift too much, and that's okay. And with this, when I lost my mom about 3 years ago, I went to a Native American ceremony, and the gentleman didn't even know me. We're walking back to the parking lot, and he says, it's okay to hurt. It's okay to hurt. Because what that hurt means is that there was a real deep love. And just imagine, I didn't feel that way when my father passed away, Tony, because we didn't have that loving relationship. I honor your pain. I went, wow, what a different way to look at it. So I encourage you to think about that as well. If that pain arises, just envelope that in love and know that that translates into love and the amount of love you did have to share with that individual. That's how short it's going to be. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I want to thank you, Sam, and all of you folks that have come out here and gotten up to that podium and told your stories. It takes an incredible amount of courage to be able to walk up there and talk about losing a son or a daughter. And I just really admire you all for being able to do it. I, too, have lost a son. And we all grieve in different ways. And what helped me a lot was he'd come back to me in dreams. I've seen him as an angel in dreams. I've relived different things that we did together. It was very comforting. The other thing, another way that I expressed my grief and found some relief from the grief was I'm a musician, and I sat down one time with a dear friend of mine, and we wrote a little song. And so a lot of times when I'm missing my boy, I just sing this song. And I feel better after I've done that. So I'd like to share it with you today. I'd like Donna to sing it for me because I don't know if I can make it through it. but it's called I Won't Forget.
Church, and so come talk now because I can't. just humbled to have been able to be here with all of you, to listen to your stories. I've thought a lot, time and time again, about what I would say, and I'm left almost without words. Just the beauty of your courage to share your stories and to trust us to hold those and to hold you all in this space. It's very humbling and is an honor and a privilege to be here with each and every one of you. I'm thankful that we were able to host this. I'm thankful that all of you have come. And I want to invite us into a little ritual of remembering. It was as I was sitting here on the front pew, I kept looking at the communion table, which says, in remembrance of me, which I will never stand behind that table on Sunday mornings because we do weekly communion. I will never see that table quite the same way again after this morning, because I will remember each of you and your stories as I stand there. So what I want to invite us into is a time of lighting a candle in remembrance of those children that we have lost. As a reminder that though they are not here with us still, their light still lives on and shines in our hearts. So I would invite you, if you're comfortable coming forward, to come forward to take light and to light a candle in memory of your loved one, and if you're comfortable doing so, to name their names aloud as you like.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be.
When the broken-hearted people living in the world agree, there will be a lesson, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see. There will be an answer, let it be.
that are on Lent for either children who have not been named here today, for loved ones who we know have lost children, and for those children who are yet to be lost. Knows the pain of losing a child. We ask for your presence and your comfort to surround us and to guide us, to help bring us people and community to walk with us in those moments when we feel like we can't take another step, to be present when there are no words. Help us to be present with one another in both the pain we share and the pain that we will never understand. Help us to walk with one another, to be light and love and grace and peace for one another, especially in these difficult times and as we look forward to celebrating the holidays. May we continue to be community for one another, light for one another, and walk and journey together through these days. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, do we have another song? That's the last one, right? Okay. When we hear our other song, which I think everyone in the world loves, and thank you all so much for sharing, and again, don't forget to go by the tree, take your veil. This is an important veil because we all really shared something very deep and very personal today. And to me, this club that we all belong to that we never wanted to join made us all just a little bit stronger for being here with each other. And those who didn't make it today just don't know what they missed. And up here, I also have another door prize for you. It's all the teddy bears, and I want you to be sure to take a pair of angel wings home with you. I have cards if you want to make a wish to put on the tree, but since we're kind of at the end of the program, I have hangers and cards and pins. Why don't you make a wish and take it home and put it on your tree? And maybe that will be a good thing. So I have them up here on the front row. And I'd like to again thank Donna and Dave so much for everything they've done today, getting us through, and all of the folks that were speakers. And we have a really good song to end on. So I think everybody ought to get up and join arms, you know. Get it, Donna.
Oh,